receive those who turn to thee in faith, love, and repentance. Look with compassion, we beseech thee, upon us who come to be cleansed in the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Grant us the light of thy Holy Spirit, that truly repenting of our sins, earnestly resolved to lead a new life, and in love and charity with all men, we may obtain thy pardon and forgiveness, and may receive to our soul salvation the precious body and blood of Jesus Christ, who with thee and the Holy Ghost liveth and reigneth ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
Our processional hymn on this Michaelmas celebration is hymn number 271.
Glorious in his saints, oh come let us all.
8 and Psalm number 91. Psalm number 8 is found. It's found on page 350 in our Book of Common Prayer. O Lord, our Governor, how excellent is thy name in all the world, thou that hast set thy glory above the heavens.
Out of the mouth of very babes and sucklings hast thou ordained strength, because of thine enemies, that thou mightest still the enemy and the avenger.
I consider thy heavens, even the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained.
What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him?
Thou madest him lower than the angels, to crown him with glory and worship.
Thou makest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands, and thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet.
All sheep and oxen, yea, and the beasts of the field,
the fowls of the air, and the fishes of the sea, and whatsoever walketh through the paths of the sea.
O Lord our Governor, how excellent is thy name in all the world. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Whoso dwelleth under the defense of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty.
I will say unto the Lord, thou art my hope and my stronghold, my God, in him will I trust.
For he shall deliver thee from the snare of the hunter and from the noisome pestilence.
He shall defend thee under his wings, and thou shalt be safe under his feathers. His faithfulness and truth shall be thy shield and buckler.
Thou shalt not be afraid for any terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day.
For the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the sickness that destroyeth in the noonday.
1,000 shall fall beside thee, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee.
Yea, with thine eyes shalt thou behold, and see the reward of the ungodly.
For thou, Lord, art my hope. Thou hast set thine house of defense very high.
There shall no evil happen unto thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling.
For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways.
They shall bear thee in their hands, that thou hurt not thy foot against a stone.
Thou shalt go upon the lion and adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou tread under thy feet.
Because he hath set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him up, because he hath known my name.
He shall call upon me, and I will hear him. Yea, I am with him in trouble. I will deliver him and bring him to honor.
With long life will I satisfy him, and show him my salvation.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Amen.
Job out of the whirlwind and said, Who is this that darkeneth counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up now thy loins like a man, for I will demand of thee, and answer thou me. Where wast thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Declare, if thou hast understanding. Who hath laid the measures thereof, if thou knowest? Or who hath stretched the line upon it? Whereupon are are the foundations thereof fastened? And who laid the cornerstone thereof? When the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy. Here endeth the first lesson.
Thanks be to God.
Said,
I am the Lord thy God. Thou shalt have none other gods but me.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not make to thyself any graven image, nor the likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or in the earth beneath, or in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down to them, nor worship them.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Remember that thou keep holy the Sabbath day.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Honor thy father and thy mother.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt do no murder.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not steal.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not covet.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and write all these thy laws in our hearts, we beseech thee.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
The epistle is written in the 12th chapter of the book of Revelation, beginning at the 7th verse. There was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, an old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, Now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and all of the sea. For the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. Here endeth the epistle.
Thanks be to God.
Our gradual hymn is hymn number 337.
Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoso shall receive one such little child in my name, receiveth me. But whoso shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me, it were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck, and that he were drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe unto the world because of offenses, for it must needs be that offenses come, but woe to that man by whom the offense cometh. Wherefore, if thy hand or thy foot offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life halt or maimed, rather than having two hands or two feet be cast into everlasting fire. And if thy eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life with one eye, rather than having two eyes to be cast into hell. Take heed that ye despise not one of these little ones. For I say unto you, that in heaven their angels do always behold the face of my Father, which is in heaven. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Thank you.
I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ,
the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary
and was made man,
and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures
and ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life,
who proceedeth from the Father and the Son,
who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by prophets. And I believe one Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated. Well, good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
What a surprise. Turned around. Vince, Father Vincent, are out here working on the altar and heard someone walk in the door and turned around. Instead of being on the other end of the camera through YouTube land, here's Dave Mahar. Great to have you.
Glad I can make it.
A long time. Long time. What a nice surprise. Well, like you said, you know, you missed one Sunday. It has been a crazy week. I was telling Dave earlier, that YouTube video of last week's service is the most viewed video we've ever made. Word has got out.
Yeah,
and what's going on? Just to recap, Chris and I and Rachel will be moving to Knoxville probably around June of next year. We'll see.
Who knows?
Who knows? But we're here. We're still here for several months. And Father Dan has departed membership of St. Michael's for other things. So Father Vince has agreed that with the vestry's approval upon my departure, he would like to fulfill the vacancy and become our new rector of St. Michael's. Then he kind of surprised all of us. I was coming up last week to talk about, okay, where do we go from here? You know, I was staying in the Grange Hall, go up to Holy Angels, or, you know, I guess there's that alternative. We'll be talking about for years to build a church without taking a great deal of money. And this man, the Holy Spirit laid it upon his heart that he's sitting up there in that big house on top of the hill, and laid it on his heart that, well, I'm going to be the new rector of St. Michael's, and, you know, this kind of tenuous situation with the Grange, he made the decision that he'll be selling his home and using the proceeds to purchase property and build St. Michael's a church, and also have a little rectory there on the hill as well. So it was kind of a shock to everybody. It's pretty amazing. And Vince explained that you all had a chance to see it on YouTube. But I informed Bishop Gibbon, our Bishop Ordinary, about this, and he was quite flabbergasted as well. But has promised he's excited, he's thrilled, and has promised his and the diocese support in any way we need to make this a reality, including the fact that when I give him the phone call, he will be on an airplane to come out and visit us. And he said, maybe after the first year, maybe some time.
Yeah.
He's still putting the diocese together, but he would like to come out, not only to come out and introduce himself and meet us, but to come out and get an idea of what he can do to support us in this project. And we're not talking about something that's going to happen immediately. But also, he, and perhaps the presiding bishop, when this becomes a reality and it's time to consecrate the church, both of them perhaps would be flying out for that blessed event. So, he's talking about doing it, maybe it's property here, you know, which is crazy. to south of here a little bit, off the freeway down here. He'll get a good real estate agent to start looking at that, and we're going to start applying favors to that. Yes, Jason?
Well, we got a land supply of, what is his, beer?
Pabst Blue Ribbon beer. Yes, our presiding bishop's favorite libation. We will have probably a couple of cases. Maybe I'll send him a case just to encourage him to fly. Bishop Giffen did suggest, and I'll probably be notifying the presiding bishop as well, because once I leave, I'll be going into the Diocese of the Eastern United States, and Bishop Chad will become my bishop out there. But like I said in the video, and I've said many places, I'm not leaving St. Michael, physically perhaps, but St. Michael's and the Deanery of the Northwest will still be under my influence. I'm a member of the Provincial Council, and I will do my darndest, as are many members of our diocese, by the way. We have a really good position there to see if we can continue the support of the diocese in St. Michael's. Father Bill is still cogitating on whether we're going to start a mission down in Corvallis. Joni has a church down there that she said they could use for services and things, so we're giving him time to think about it. But if that's something he'd like to do, it would be a wonderful thing. So I think we don't. Oh yeah, I need one more volunteer for the vestry to get us up to the 5 minimum that we have to have. I have to send out an email. We do have some things that we need to start doing. I guess if we don't get a volunteer, we can just the existing vestry can just make a. Exception, and we'll vote on it next annual meeting. But we need to get him locked in now as our new curate and start cogitating on how we're going to go forward with this. I'm going to suggest to him that he go find a good attorney and a good accountant. Yeah.
I'll see if I can maybe get Lori to sign back on too.
Okay. We'll see. So that's it. Soon to be Mr. Curate. Do you have anything you'd like to say?
Oh, just I just wanted to repeat again how blessed I feel for this opportunity. God works his miracles in many varied ways.
Downright weird.
Including the real estate market.
I cannot say more than just I thank all the good work that Father Dan has done over all these years. Repeat again that we need to pray for this man so that he finds his way in life and follows the will of God with holiness on the path toward righteousness.
And we have to make sure we find some property where you can put your big ham radio in.
Yes.
He's got this huge, he's a ham guy here. He's got this huge tower on the back of his backyard, so we'll have to make sure that it's possible.
As I was also saying last week, with Holy Angels, I had a home, it was also a church. Now I hope to have a church that is also a home. And I was just telling Bob a little bit earlier that I had recalled a English saint of the 14th century, Saint Julian of Norwich. Nobody knows her real name. That was the name of the church, Saint Julian's Church in Norwich, England, southeast England. And it was the custom in those days that a church had a little building attached to it, and this was called an anchor hold, and the person who resided there was generally a woman, so it was an anchoress. She was anchoress there. It was a dismal place. One room with one window and a slot through which food could be brought to that person, as they were expected never to leave that little structure for the rest of their lives.
That's where I live.
There we go. He's got a new patron saint.
Absolutely. And the people bring food to you if you
stop. If they stop by and ask for it.
Well, hopefully, so
I hope to have more than this.
I was going to say, hopefully, you'll have more than. Okay, Mr. Warden, anything you'd like to bring up, say?
Yeah,
it's crazy.
Like I said before, I'm speechless, so enjoy the silence.
So we're going to be, like I said, we're going to be getting, I'm going to suggest that we get definitely professional assistance on this. take our time, do it right. I'll be asking both his grace and Bishop Gibbon for their input into this. Find some churches that have had churches built for them, so maybe we can find some architects. All wonderful stuff. We're going to proceed very carefully on this. We need to have, when we find out how Father Vince wants to proceed, then St. Michael's will work with him to make this a reality. So, okay, God bless us, everyone. Hang on. Father Chris, the rector down at St. Andrews in Jacksonville, I sent him the link, and I sent an email out to Father Chris and Father Bill, just letting them know what was going on. And he said, when I was watching that video, I needed to have a seatbelt on. He said, it's just an emotional yo-yo. You guys are leaving, and then Father Dan's left. But now all of a sudden, Father Vince is going to do this miracle, and it's just, he just said it was great, and he's very excited. He hopes to be a part of helping us do this as well. So, with that, I've eliminated the sermon hymn. So I'm going to turn it over to Father Vince. He'll give a sermon. I'm disappearing just like charcoal. I'll be back. Over to you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our Savior and Redeemer.
Amen.
Angels are with us. They're here. They're everywhere. They are with us. They're our guardians and our protectors. They are our helpers and guides on our journey through life in our quest for holiness. They do not give us graces, as those helps come only from God, but at God's direction, the angels guard and protect us from all evil. Angels are servants and messengers of God. Their office or function comes from the Greek word for messenger, angelos. But as we will see, they are more, much more, than just Western Union messengers. Angels are beings or spirits that are part of those things unseen St. Paul refers to in the second letter to the Corinthians, as he admonishes us to look to the eternal and not to the temporal. Yes, unseen, yet as real as the ground we walk upon. We are created a little bit lower than the angels. They are pure spirit, yet have often taken the form of men, as we learn from Scripture. Three angels appear to Abraham with news of Sarah's forthcoming birth of her son Isaac. And an angel prevented Abraham from sacrificing Isaac on an altar of wood. And Isaac's son Jacob wrestled with an angel. He wrestled all night long as he became the Israel, new name, Israel, the father of a mighty nation. Angels have often been sent by God as messengers and guides, as we read in both the Old and New Testaments. God sent an angel to lead the Hebrews in their journey from Egypt to the land of Canaan over a 40-year period. An angel appeared to Gideon, telling him that he was given the task of saving Israel from the Midianites. Then there were the three young men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who survived the flames of Nebuchadnezzar's furnace by the help of an angel. And Daniel in the lion's den, when an angel shut the mouth of the lion so that Daniel was not eaten. Saint Michael, the archangel, appears to Daniel as well, telling him to be strong and fear not, for the Lord is with him in battle. In the New Testament, we learn that St. Gabriel appears to the Blessed Virgin Mary, informing her that she is to be the Mother of God and give birth to Jesus by and through the power of the Holy Ghost. An angel appears to Joseph in a dream, reassuring him to have no fear in taking Mary as his wife, for it was through the Holy Ghost that the child was conceived in her and not by adulterous relations at all. Then, in St. Luke's Gospel, he tells us of angels heralding the birth of Jesus to the shepherds, crying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill to men." Later on in the New Testament, we hear of two angels in the tomb of Jesus who meet Mary Magdalene, asking her, "Why weepest thou?" And at the second coming of Jesus, he will be accompanied by his angels. Quoting St. Matthew's Gospel, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God." That's a trumpet blast, by the way, not a person. "And the dead in Christ shall rise first." I could go on and on, as there are many, many references in sacred scripture to angels. The foregoing is but a few of the most prominent. All of this mini Bible study that you're having here this morning, having been said, what is our relationship with angels here and now? Well, St. Paul gives us some insight into that in his letter to the Hebrews, as he advises us to be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. As mentioned earlier, Abram and Sarai did this, and God blessed her with a son, even in her old age. That is why she named the child Isaac, which means laughter in Hebrew, because she thought it was all a joke that she could become pregnant and give birth in her advanced years. In St. Paul's letter to the Hebrews, we are told that angels are with us, ministering to us in many and varied ways. Our guardian angels are the foremost example of this blessed gift from God. We know that they exist, and that each of us has a guardian angel, because it is revealed in sacred scripture, most clearly in Psalm 91, verses 10 through 12, quoting that, "There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling, for he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone." As messengers, our guardian angels communicate God's will for us in varied ways. If we pray to our guardian angel for help, because they are saints, we can expect a reply in some subtle ways, or as in the case of Jacob, who wrestled with his angel and suffered injury to his thigh, not so subtle ways. A close friend or family member might be inspired by our angel to give us an answer that will guide us on the right paths and to find a better way. Sometimes we hear the message from circumstances that give us insight into what we should do or not do. Perhaps it is the example of someone else's experience that closely relates to our condition that provides insight into how we are to proceed, or perhaps someone else defers to our judgment or just vanishes from consideration for an objective or objective we might be seeking. There are myriad ways that messages come to us from divine providence. Our guardian angels are just one way. But in all cases, the message either originates from God himself or is in accordance with his will and plan for us. Our guardian angels are here for us. They are saints in heaven, and as such are messengers of goodness. However, that has not always been the case, as we did learn from today's gospel reading from the book of Revelation. There was a war in heaven, and certain angels deviated from their goodness and chose evil. Also, "Better to reign in hell than serve in heaven," from Paradise Lost by John Milton, one answer. But all angels have an intellect and free will. They may use that intellect and free will for good or evil, just as we might do. But their predilection is to goodness, as that is their nature. Exactly how Satan and his cohorts were able to defy their nature and turn to the dark side is a mystery to us. But some authors have proposed and propounded that Satan believed he was self-created and thus was God's equal, but opposite in character. Saint Michael was a general of sorts, commanding the army of holy angels who were defenders of the faith and of God's omnipotence, with chivalry, honor, and most of all, virtue. They are analogous to King Arthur's legendary Knights of the Round Table or Charlemagne's fictional paladins. They knew and accepted with loving obeisance that God is God and they are not. However, Satan, in Hebrew the name Satan means one who plots against another, and his cohorts took another path. He and they sought greater power and reward. They were motivated by the very thing that the serpent used to delude Adam and Eve in the garden, to be able to define and determine in their own minds and by their own will what was good and what was evil. How ironic that the very thing that resulted in the fallen angels being cast out from heaven was the same thing that resulted in the fall of man. It is the sin of pride, false pride, that deludes one into believing that they can become like gods. Thusly, Satan and his crew of deviants were cast out and cast down upon earth. Once here, they decided that they would corrupt humanity in accordance with their fallen state of being. Why so? Well, because Satan and his fallen angels knew that God had created humanity in his image and likeness, and that, as defined by Saint Bernard of Clairvaux, is free will and virtue, especially faith, hope, and love. Satan knew that God loves us, and that old demon, that dragon, was jealous. Satan knew that humanity had a weakness. He knew that we are imperfect, and that we can be easily deceived by speciousness and lies that sound too good to be true, but seem attainable nonetheless. Just as God created us out of his love to become his adopted children, so too did Satan wish to have us transformed from goodness and love into evil and hate. Thus, we might become the children of the devil. Consider from the book of Job. The Lord said unto Satan, "Whence comest thou?" Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro in the earth, walking up and down in it." Satan spent his days seeking poor souls that might be corrupted. Not satisfied with his power of deception toward humanity, Satan became an accuser of man before God day and night. He perpetrated lies and deceit in the face of God, but God would have none of it. Instead, God, out of his love of man, sent his only begotten Son, Jesus, to earth for our salvation. Some have pondered the question of possible repentance and salvation for Satan and his fallen angels out of God's mercy. The answer is most likely no, because theirs was an irrevocable choice of free will that resulted in an ontological change in their former angelic being. Their hearts and minds were transformed from goodness into pure evil. Not that they merely commit evil deeds, but that their nature has become evil itself. Just as God is love, Satan and his devils are evil. No reform, no repentance, no do-overs are possible. Theirs is the kingdom of hate. So let us rejoice and be glad that we are on a path toward holiness that brings us ever closer to God and his heavenly kingdom, with his angels there to guide and direct and shepherd us onto right paths. And now to God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, be ascribed as is most just to you, all might, majesty, dominion, power, and glory, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
Shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, ye have done it unto me. I kind of like to think that we're at the end of the beginning with St. Michael's. And I'm standing here probably, and Chris, reflecting back on where we all started in our dining room with Dr. Walraven. I can remember going to his apartment every Sunday and loading up all his sound gear, unloading it, putting it in our dining room, and then after service, loading it all up, then taking it back. Heady days they were, but here we are. We've been in our beloved LaGrange Hall all these years. We've gone through ups and downs. We've survived pestilence and pandemic. And just when some people were probably thinking that we were down and out, God works a miracle, and now we're looking at perhaps in a year or so, leading you in your home. So God be praised. Never saw that one coming. Did not see that one coming. And you know, it's funny because I'm just thinking about how God works. Here's a man whose church turned their back on him. And he was, what do I do now, God? I earned my Master's of Divinity. I was going through the diaconate program with the Roman Catholic Church, and now they said, that's not going to happen. They abandoned me. What do I do? And so he calls Father Walt, who at the time was the Vicar General of the Diocese of the West. Had a chat with him, and Father Walt said, well, you better call Father Hawkins. Maybe they can do something with him. And long story short is, we did do something with this guy. We sponsored him. He became a deacon, and then he was priested. And you know, he came very close to accepting the rectorship down at All Saints in Prescott. He actually went down there, was interviewed. We thought we were going to lose him. God had other plans, obviously. We've gone through all sorts of interesting permutations of holy angels. I think it was all a test. I think it was testing our strength and our faith and our situativeness. And by golly, you know, we're going to make it. And so here we are.
Well, the RC, all I can say is God closes the door, God opens the window.
Opens the window.
There you go. Well said. I did not see any prayer intents on there. Does anybody have any prayer requests or concerns? Or
well, I didn't see a sheet of paper back there, but yeah. other than prayers from my brother,
right.
For Jim, I'll email you and kind of let you know what's going on. Maybe you can send it out to everybody.
Yes.
But also a couple things dawned on me while I was sitting here in the pew. One of the reasons that I came down here was to get a new driver's license, or get my driver's license renewed, which means I got a birthday coming up. And it's this Friday, and I'd like a birthday blessing, but I'm going to wait till next week and watch it on video and get it somewhat posthumously.
Let's take care of that right now.
Amen.
Amen. Okay. Well, it's on page 597. Anybody want to come up here? What? Wonderful.
Yeah.
All right, the Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Watch over thy child, O Lord, as his days increase. Bless and guide him wherever he may be, keeping him unspotted from the world. Strengthen him when he stands, comfort him when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise him up if he falls. And in his heart may thy peace, which passeth understanding, abide all the days of his life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Peace, which passeth understanding, abide all the days of his life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Congratulations.
There's only one thing about it. I don't like the word sober.
Well, we should probably have a prayers for a day safe trip back up. You're going back up to Seattle?
Yeah, I got to go up Tuesday morning on choo-choo. It's 4 hours of stretching. I'd rather drive at 70.
And ultimately for a safe return back to Mexico, for all the rest of you who are out there driving, please be careful. I guess it was a big crash on I-5. It's pretty bad, but it's... any other requests? How are you doing?
I'm great.
You look great.
Great. With all the prayers and everything,
you look great.
I'm doing great.
In honor of it being our Patron Saints Day, I went ahead and sprung for beautiful roses, so be sure to take some of those home, please. We want those to be appreciated. And that's about it. As we always do, let's pray for our brave men and women of the armed forces and their families who protect our liberties and our first responders, our police, our EMTs, healthcare workers, and border regions who are having a particularly bad week. Let us pray for the whole state of Christ Church. Almighty and ever-living God, by thy holy apostle hast taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations and receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also, so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, remembering especially our presiding bishop, Bishop Chad, and our bishop ordinary, Bishop Robert, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. To all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that, with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee, of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to grant them continued growth in thy love and service, and to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Ye who do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God, devoutly. Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge in any way all our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time
this grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ saith unto all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul said. This is a true saying, and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John said. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, who suffered death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself, once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel, command us to continue, a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice, until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. He had given thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many, for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance. Of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. We, thy humble servants, do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these holy gifts which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make. Adding in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. We most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness, vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. We earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that, by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we, and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion, may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and make one body with him. He may dwell in us, and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We do not presume
to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sins
soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever living God,
we most heartily thank thee for that thou hast vouchsafed to feed us, who have duly received these holy mysteries, with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of his most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost, in all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Thank you.
with you.